Good morning. I'm Elizabeth Mefford. I am the Vice President of Resource Development and Donor Relations for United Way of Williamson County. And I have the pleasure of being your chair for Breakfast with the Mayors this year. And so if you'll go ahead and take your seats, I'm going to go start thanking our sponsors. We want to thank Pinnacle Financial Partners for their continued support this year. They have been a wonderful partner with us at Breakfast with the Mayor, so please give them a round of applause. And then we would also like to thank Williamson Medical Center, Tennessee Equine Hospital, Williamson County Association of Realtors, Haven and Sawyer, Berry Farms Animal Hospital, and who got to eat some wonderful breakfast this morning? That's right. Thank you to Pockets. And who was the first thing you got this morning was MJ Roasting Coffee. That's right. Can't have a breakfast without coffee, I don't think, right? So just appreciate all of them. And then we also want to thank Andrews Transportation Group and Rolling Hills Community Church for hosting us this morning and for always having such a wonderful facility that we get to use for Breakfast with the Mayors. Joining us as a platinum partner for the next year is Embry Partners, represented today by Brad Canole. Brad, are you here? Appreciate you. Thank you in the back. And then right now, if you will go ahead and please take a seat, I'm going to introduce Mindy Tate, who's your executive director for Franklin Tomorrow and chair of the board, Mr. Tim Murphy.
You can put that one back down.
Thank you, Elizabeth.
I don't often ask you, did you check in this morning?
I did check in, and it was really easy. And I noticed that a lot of you out there have been checking in because it says check in with us this morning. But if you haven't, get your phone out, hold it up.
Okay. Who's already checked in? Okay, if you've checked in, thank you.
Everybody's already checked in, or if you haven't, just open your text app and then key in the number up here, 2. That's where you're going to send the text. And then just type in breakfast. Hit send, and you'll be checked in, and Mindy will be happy.
Y'all want me to be happy, right? I mean, that's a good start to the day. But I want you to be able to be among the first people to know about our new initiative. We've been teasing this for a couple weeks to the public, but we've got a new initiative we're going to launch today, this morning, and that's called On the Table. And if you are signed in, you'll be among the first people to get information regarding our new initiative. And Tim, we're going to talk a little bit about it, right?
Well, yeah, I was just going to let you, though, because you're the one that sort of came up with this idea. So what is On the Table, Mindy?
On the Table, simply stated, is a day of discussion built around dining. We're very excited to bring this to Franklin. We're a community visioning and engagement organization. And so we're always looking for new ways to engage you in our activities, but also in our community. That's why we had you check in today. But On the Table was created by the Chicago Community Trust many years ago and has been replicated by cities across the country. And it really is a chance to bring people together to talk about the things that are great in our community and things that can be better, but working together and having constructive and civil conversations. We are patterning our program after our friends in Lexington, Kentucky, where we were lucky enough to visit earlier this year for an On the Table experience. The Bluegrass Community Foundation has put together a video that shows kind of what On the Table is, and we think it can explain to you in better terms than we can talk about right now. So we're going to roll a video, and then we'll bring out our co-chairs for this event. Thanks so much.
Great. On the table.
On the table.
On the table.
On the table.
On the table. On the table.
On the table.
On the Table is a community event. It's a wonderful way to come together and share ideas of what we can do to improve our town.
I think the best way to explain it is this is democracy at its best.
We're glad to have our community residents coming out and just sitting around the table, fellowshipping, not only fellowshipping, but also sharing what can we do to make matters better and life better in our community.
We need to be talking to our neighbors in counties to our north, south, east, and west, and that we need to be talking with our own neighbors in different neighborhoods across our community.
On the Table's given Frankfort and Franklin County an opportunity to get folks together to talk about the good, the bad, and the ugly, where their community needs to go and how they're going to get there.
The conversations on the table, they mean a lot to me because I'm new to this community. By having these conversations and listening to this conversation, it's helping me to understand Lexington.
Programs that we've talked about and getting them out there, but what can we do here at this table to start getting that word out there and making us a stronger community?
Pay attention to him so you can get a feel of what's going on there and what he's thinking.
And so that's what inspires me, you know? If I'm not relevant to you, I'm gonna be relevant.
Our goal as in being a partner here is to increase that civic engagement, and we want to make information easily available for people and show people that it can be easy to engage civically and how important that is and how you can affect change.
It offers an opportunity to have discussions but also prescribe solutions to certain situations. We talked a lot about what inspired us in our communities, but we also talked about the elephants in the room and some of the things that hold communities back.
We don't have all the answers, but I think that most of the folks can walk away from here today taking the steps that need to begin the process to work for those solutions.
On the Table to me is just a really exciting way for people to get together that may have never gotten together before. It's a chance to hear ideas from other people that you maybe would have never met and just potentially see your ideas actually come to light, which is really exciting.
The idea is that we have quality conversations. I don't know if the quantity even matters. Maybe really listening to a story, connecting with that person in a way that you didn't expect to, and then possibly moving forward to change for the better. I really do think it's all about that.
So, wow. So now you have your first taste of On the Table. No pun intended there. Mindy, you came to the board at Franklin tomorrow with this idea a few months ago, and our board enthusiastically endorsed it. And we're really proud to have four of our board members who have volunteered to serve as the co-chairs for our On the Table event or initiative on October 30th.
And those four board members are Lena Bell, Jim Roberts, Mary Lee Bennett, and Patrick Baggett. And they're going to tell you all a little bit more about On the Table and perhaps feed your interest. So I'm going to turn it over to them for a little bit.
Good morning. Alina Bell. Why On the Table? It's our mission. At Franklin Tomorrow, we are committed to bringing people together to create a more generous, vibrant, an engaged community.
Good morning, I'm Jim Roberts. Why On the Table? My goodness. Now more than ever before, people need to connect, engage, know their neighbors, and participate in civil and civic conversations. And my goal is what I'm really looking forward to is the ability to connect with people that I don't normally connect with or know.
And isn't it true that big ideas can start from small conversations? And think about all of the wonderful things that have started with just a small, initial conversation. And so that's the hope for this. And then when we invest as people, as a community, in the ideas that we create through these conversations, I mean, how much more impactful will that be? Our hope is that through all of this, that we will engage a blended cross-section of the community so that we can build big ideas for our community's future.
Good morning, I'm Mary Lee Bennett. Why on the table? On the table provides our community the opportunity to bring many voices together and encourages conversations to share ideas and thoughts about our future. We want to invite everyone from all parts of Franklin to participate in the conversation, and we hope these conversations will inspire people to take action to create positive change in our community.
So what is on the table? It's a one-day community engagement initiative. It's Franklin-wide community conversations. It's small groups of 8 to 12 people, and everyone is invited to host or attend. When is it? It's October the 30th this year, and the kickoff will be here at Breakfast in the Mayor's, and this room will be set up completely different from what you see it today. But there's maximum flexibility for the host in that you can host your gathering in days surrounding October the 30th.
When you serve food at a meeting, it becomes a gathering. So October the 30th, my day is going to look like I'm going to be here at Breakfast with the Mayor's hosting a table. My daughter, that's an eighth grader, has given me permission to go over to Freedom Middle School and join her with her friends and the other National Junior Honor Society members and hear their voice. I'll have tea time at my home, and then my family is so excited about hosting a hot dog celebration. So Eric and Chris, I see you out there. I need you guys to come over to my house and join me for that celebration.
And I'm going to be right here with Breakfast with the Mayor's, Alina, and host a table along with you. And then other events during the day will be a neighborhood gathering as well as some other organizations.
What about you, Mary Lee?
Well, I plan to be out at West Haven, of course, where we're going to be a super host. And what a super host means is that we're going to have multiple tables in one location and hopefully have a gathering of lots of people to have some great conversations.
And I know that Rotary has to be a part of your world, Patrick.
It is. And we at the Franklin Noon Rotary are going to have, Jim, you mentioned maximum flexibility. And there is maximum flexibility in how you schedule your host table. But Franklin Noon Rotary will have, at our regular meeting on that Thursday, we will have an on-the-table experience. But also other civic organizations, the Lions Club and others, and other Rotarian or Rotary groups in town are going to use their meeting time to also, as public events, for anyone to join in. Now, Lena, am I going to have to break out the fine china for this?
Only if you do the dishes.
Well, we're not going to have the fine china at the Baggett House. I know that.
That brings me to a great point. Where is on the table events going to take place? Well, they're going to be at public venues like our parks, offices, library, places of worship, restaurants. As I mentioned, I'm headed to schools, and you're welcome to host private venues where you're having it within your home. And what kind of foods are you going to have? Well, I mentioned I'm going to have hot dogs, tea, cookies, vegetables, budget-friendly items. So feel free to be as elaborate as you'd like or stay with the budget.
So at this point, I'm sure you're asking, what can I do? Well, we'd like to ask you to have a conversation. These conversations will last approximately 1 hour and really get to the heart of the quality of life in Franklin. And not just what's great about it, but how we can make it better, more sustainable, safer, stronger, and more vibrant. I recently had the experience of attending On the Table in Lexington, Kentucky, and it was great to meet the people there and hear their conversations and listen to their stories and see how insightful and thoughtful they were about what they were talking about in their town. And they have lots of things that are similar to Franklin in that they were concerned about mixing new and old with the historic downtown that they have there in Lexington. They have places where rural and urban land uses meet and how are they going to deal with that going forward in the future. They're experiencing some great growth in Lexington just like we are here, and those were all topics that were very interesting to hear their thoughts on. It was one of the best experiences I've ever had and just knew it was the right thing for Franklin to do. So how can you participate? Well, we would like to invite each and every one of you to be a guest at a table somewhere in Franklin around September the 30th, October the 30th. Oops. If you also would like to be a host or a super host, you could go to the website and get all kinds of information about what that entails. As you've heard us say, many civic clubs and businesses will be hosting tables all around the city, so you can find one that will suit your schedule. And we hope that you will join us and be part of the conversation. The best part about On the Table is it's free to attend. Absolutely no cost for you, and anyone can participate. And we want to invite people who live, work, and play in Franklin, so it's not just for residents. Hopefully you'll learn something new about the community and meet some new people. And we hope that you will enjoy the conversation.
And if you volunteer to be a host, we'll provide you with the tools you need to do that. We'll provide you with a toolkit. We'll provide you with access to a website and social media and a fact sheet and do the training for you and help you with training so that you can host properly. Patrick, how do we register?
It's a great question, Jim. How do we register and how do you get to join the conversation? This, Mindy has already mentioned the new texting function that we had here this morning, and that is for a reason. If you text 629-206-5895, you got an automatic reply. At 8:45, or as soon as the program's over, you're going to get another text. So everyone, if you haven't done it now, text this number, text breakfast to this number, and then you're going to get a text back with a link in it, so you don't have to go searching. And you're going to get to click it, and it will take you straight to our webpage, which is franklintomorrow.org/onthetable, where you as an individual or as a sponsor or as a table host, or if you want to be a super host like what Mary Lee, you can do all of that online. And also, you're going to get updates, communication, so that you're in the loop for what this event is going to be, and you're up to date. So please, please do that. If you want to engage further, head to our website or via the text and get involved. Mindy, we have lots of partners that have already signed up for this, but we need more. Can you tell us more about that?
That's right. Thank you. Let's thank these people first. They have put a lot of work into this, and a lot of work is ahead of us. But we've been meeting with a number of community organizations and partners already. And we have partnership commitments because one of our missions is to collaborate, not just to engage, but to foster collaboration. And so we're looking forward to working with our partners that include the City of Franklin, the Williams County Association of Realtors, the Franklin Housing Authority, Williamson Inc., Williamson County Association of Realtors, the Franklin Special School District, Leadership Franklin, the Lions Club, Franklin Synergy Bank, Vanderbilt University, New Hope Academy, Rotary, Lions Club. We're very excited about our partners, but there's room for more partners because this is a community-wide event. Your business, your church, your neighborhood, in your home, we need you to be our partner. So what are the next steps and what are ways that you can get connected? Well, again, I'm going to say it one more time. If you haven't already texted breakfast to that number, please do so so that you can stay connected to our On the Table updates. Secondly, join our steering committee or one of the subcommittees that's working to make On the Table a success this year. Sign up to participate on October 30th, whether that means as a guest or as a host or to get this program into your business. Just think about that. We know that over 50% of the people who work in Williamson County are commuting in, but they need to have their voice heard as well as the citizens. So we look forward to working with Williamson Inc. and others to bring this to businesses in our community. We also hope that you'll tell your friends and neighbors. When you leave, you're going to get a little reminder, save the date card, and a chip clip to help you remember that. And then we'd ask you to consider sponsoring the dialogue by being our partner financially in presenting On the Table. But most important is to ask you to commit to participate on October 30th or during that week in one of the civic group or other organizations that'll be holding their events perhaps on a day around October 30th. This is a conversation for our community, and that includes everyone in this room and beyond. And so we're excited to bring On the Table to Franklin. If you have any questions, you can email me, mindy@franklintomorrow.org or call us at our office. But thank you so much for your time this morning, and we're going to move on to the next part of our program with the mayors. Thanks, guys. They actually have coffee up here this morning, so and muffins, so that if they start eating, I can't control them, you know that. So, good morning.
Where are you going? I'm going to get away.
Okay, just sit way over there. Great, okay, well.
Spread out a little bit.
Okay, y'all spread out a little bit. So, how's it been? Y'all been busy? No, nothing going on. Rogers, it was kind of the week of Rogers last week. With the State of the County address, and then you were at Williamson Inc.'s town hall meeting. But it seemed like Ken always leaves town when you're during the week of Rogers. Is that right?
I had not thought of it that way, Mindy. I think Ken was on vacation, but we had a good week. Just talking about the many things we're doing here in Williamson County, and. It's always gratifying to be able to talk. I know Ken would feel the same way about the state of the city, but the state of the county, it's a wonderful place to live and work. And the event that you're all trying to do on October the 30th, that would be another step in helping all of us lead and direct and try to follow up on some of those ideas.
What do you think was the most give us the top two or three points from your State of the County address off the top of your head, sorry. But give us the top two or three.
Well,
Ken will make notes.
Now, Williamson County continues to, I think, be a leader in so many things. One of them is public education. Public education, parks and recreation, your public safety division, all of those are with purpose, have been going on for 20 and 25 years, most of the areas. And so the real challenge for Williamson County, one of the questions that were submitted, I know, was how do we handle the growth over the next 5 years? How do we continue to have this quaint place that we call home with this fast-growing, rapid population growth that we're seeing? And those are always challenges, balancing budgets, balancing numbers, and at the same time, helping to be very proactive in business and business recruitment.
Great. So, Ken, you were on vacation last week. Well planned out. Board of Mayor and Alderman doesn't meet the second meeting in July, so it's a great time for the Board of Mayor and Alderman to get a break.
And that's traditionally whenever my wife and I try to take a little trip. And Rogers, I hate to tell you the truth. I thought about getting up in the middle of the night and see if it was live streaming, but I didn't. So, but I did watch a little bit of it later on the internet. So congratulations, a little bit. Well, we got the lunch call, and then we got the dinner call, then we got the bedtime call. But no, I did listen to some of it, and congratulations on the great work that you're doing leading the county and with your commission. And we enjoy that partnership that we have with the county and so many things that we're working synergistically on.
So there are a lot of things going on in the city. So give us an update on the top three things that you're working on with the Board of Mayor and Aldermen and staff right now.
Well, I think the first thing I would comment about is the budget process is over. We've passed a budget. The budget is balanced. Our revenues equal our expenditures, and that's good. I think probably one of the most important decisions has been made in a long time is the fact that we have accepted a bid to build a new water reclamation facility, $132 million facility. It'll be the largest single capital project the city of Franklin has done. We have over $100 million worth of state revolving loan fund money promised at 1.47%, and then we'll also be using some cash on this. So this is important for us to continue to be able to support the growth that our community is experiencing. I think it's, you know, I hear a lot about traffic. we continue to work on a lot of different projects. The past 5 years, we've spent about $170 million on infrastructure projects, and going forward for the next 5 years, we're going to spend double that.
Wow.
We're utilizing things such as grants. We just got a air mitigation quality, I think, what's the term I'm looking for?
You're on your own.
Yeah, that's CMAQ fund.
Okay.
We got some CMAQ funding to work on the signalization along 96 East. We just recently got a 12-month number as far as how much money's been permitted in our community. It's $906 million. We're seeing a lot of visitors, 1.51 million visitors last year. I think an interesting thing that recently happened was that we were recognized by livability.com as being the seventh best place for STEM workers, which that was a little bit of a shock to me because we worked hard to try to get those numbers up. And then lastly, you're going to be seeing some changes in downtown as far as parking. We have 1,300 free parking spots downtown. Some of those spots in the core of the city, we're going to be changing the time limit from 4 hours to 2 hours. So you'll be seeing some new signage go up for that in the near future.
Well, parking is one of the questions that we got a lot about downtown parking, and how a lot of the lots seem to be going to paid parking as opposed to the free parking that they've been in the past. Is the city considering another parking garage? And someone even asked if the city would consider a parking garage for the Hill property instead of housing.
Well, that's not been mentioned that I'm aware of as far as visioning a parking garage on the Hill property there next to the Sonic. The board has weighed in on this, and they want to see the land use plan changed and have housing in that location. We continue to explore what's the next step as far as parking. Certainly this, we'll be doing some restriping. We're gonna be changing some times. Those are initial changes that was recommended by the study that we had. Long-term, we do need another parking garage. I was involved in a meeting yesterday with a consultant, and we discussed some possibilities. But again, just exploring what those possibilities would be for the future. Right now, we continue to have 1,300 free parking spots. Our garages are free. We've instituted a counting system so people will know if there are spaces in garages. So we hope some of these short-term measures will be of some benefit.
And it really is, some of this is a balance with the county. Williamson County, as you maintain court functions in the downtown area, and that's How do you feel about keeping the courthouse and those facilities in downtown and how that balances out with employees? Because I've heard numbers that there are about 1,200 employees working in downtown Franklin.
So over the last year and a half, we've had a group of citizens and employees that have come together, about 36 people. We designated it a JJJ task force, Jules, jails, and judges, to look at our judicial system and how we're operating. One of those concerns that came up, we have the historical courtroom, and then we have the judicial center that was built a little over 10 years ago in the partnership with parking that Ken referred to, the garage. At that particular time, we probably miscalculated some of the numbers of the people moving into our community and the people that are using our judicial system. We labeled the historical courtroom as a place not so much for the trials that we have, and now we're changing that spectrum and having to go back and retrofit some of the historical jails so they can be used on a day-by-day basis. Beginning here in a month, on September the 1st, the legislators have approved a new judge that will service the Williamson County and the lower counties. That judge's job primarily is to work in the lower counties, but that'll free up one of the judges that we have to hear the court cases at our judicial centers. In going through that process that these men and women met for about 18 months, it was very apparent that the county make every effort to keep the courtrooms and the courtroom spaces downtown Franklin, rather than going on an off-site place and doing a new judicial center to continue on with the viability of what is occurring in Franklin. On any given day, there are a lot of cars coming in and out of the garages and people walking to go to court, from the misdemeanor of speeding ticket to the more serious crimes that they're involved. So it is the effort of the group. We are within just a couple of months of picking a master planner that will take the court system that we know, the judicial, the same problems exist overall from Century Court with our juveniles. As our community continues to grow, the children, we get into those mischievous years, we're seeing more and more activity at the juvenile center, and then finally the jail. We know we're going to need a new jail. It's about 30 years old. We're going to need a new jail in the next 4 to 5, 6 years. Finding a place for all of this is in a growing community is a very difficult thing, but currently we're planning on staying downtown with the judicial centers, so that'll make people happy in the retail business, the lawyers happy, and at the same time we'll be able to live with that, but we will have to make some modifications and probably build up a little bit more. We just need more space.
I mean, you're finding that to be true, though, on West Main Street at the Williamson County Administrative Complex, the former Williamson Medical Center, Williamson County Hospital. Could you have believed when y'all moved in there? Talk a little bit about the history of moving there and what it meant to Williamson County and how it's kind of outgrown already.
In the mid-1980s, the medical center decided to leave West Main and go to where we know it's at now, on Edward Curt Lane and Highway 96. And that facility they gave back to the county to use for office space. And of course, we're very crowded over there with the services that we're offering to the people. For an example, over the next 18 to 24 months, we'll be relocating our election commission. Over the last couple of weeks with early voting, and I know there are several of the candidates here, between the schools, between the normal traffic of just getting your car tags, there's just virtually no place to park over there. So we'll be moving the election commission down on Downs Boulevard, which used to be the old Lojack building, and we'll be converting that. So that'll give us some relief there. The school system, and they're in very small quarters over there, but it gets to be a balance of how do you spend your money for new schools or for central office, and Dr. Looney and the school board have elected to let's keep going with the schools. So we're seeing a lot of growth internally. Our jails, our court system, our election commission will be moving out. We're relocating an animal center. We'll be building it. So there are several new things on the horizon that the county's got to try to figure out how to match up with this growth that we continue to have.
One of the things you mentioned was your car tags, and there's been a legislative action to remove Williamson County from the non-attainment area as it relates to emissions testing. How long is that in place, though, before people won't have to have emissions testing on their vehicles?
So the law that was passed by the legislators on the Hill did pass it effective. I think it was actually July 1 this year. But all of us have contracts with a particular company that offer offer that service, that you have to go have your car inspected. That goes back nearly 15, 20 years ago, that the air quality that Ken was talking about early, some of the areas, the air quality, the ozone emissions, et cetera, it required all the cities and the counties to, in the Middle Tennessee area, to participate in it. It was a mandate. Now the counties outside our area, Murray County, didn't have to participate. So the legislators said that the air quality has improved. Car manufacturers have done a better job of controlling the emissions of O2. And so they passed a law that says you no longer have to do that. Unfortunately, though, you have contracts in place, and our contract will run its gamut in about 3 years. So the legislators, one of the things they'll have to take up next year is to unbundle those contracts so that we can let the citizens not have their cars inspected. Today, you still need to have it inspected, and you have to come over. Even though the legislators did that, the backside of it was a contract that held our feet to the fire.
But you don't have to go to the county complex to renew your tax.
No, you don't. And you don't have to go to the only one for the inspection. You can go to Brentwood, you can go to Franklin. Your car tags now can be renewed. There's many ways. We have kiosks in many of the parks and recreation facilities that you can get those car tags issued. You can do the traditional snail mail, or you can do just do it online and they'll direct mail it. But we still have a lot of people that like to drink coffee and congregate in the hallways the last 3 days.
So you have a special car tag, don't you?
I do have a special car tag. It's number 1000. It's got Franklin Tomorrow on it. Many years ago when you started the program, I think John Schroer bought number 100 or one. Once again, the county mayor had to go all the way to 1,000.
Ken, what's your number?
0085. Oops. 0085.
Right.
And well, my wife's is 0064.
Have you tried to negotiate with Commissioner Schroer to get one from him or anything?
You know, I haven't asked that, but I think that's a good idea. I have a feeling I know Commissioner Schroer's response, too.
Even though you're mayor of the year in Tennessee by the TML?
Oh. Wow. Thanks for the applause. I've got a great staff that facilitates how the city runs, and I attribute all that to them because we have so many great employees. But I was very honored.
Well, I think one of the reasons you were honored with that award is that you are involved regionally. Both of you are involved regionally, but you also work together. I don't think that we're going to see you at Puckett's having coffee one morning, most often, not every week or so. But tell us how you work together and why it's important to work regionally here in Middle Tennessee.
Well, I think you're exactly right. The mayors do participate on a regional basis, and there's a number of opportunities. We all serve on the Metropolitan Planning Organization, which is now come under the umbrella of the Greater Nashville Regional Council, which we also serve together on. We are part of the Regional Transit Authority and also part of the Mayor's Caucus, and the current chairman of the Mayor's Caucus happens to be sitting to my right and is doing a great job. And I think the significance of that, particularly the Mayor's Caucus is just an informal opportunity for mayors to come together. We have no power to elect or vote, but it's an opportunity for 40 mayors representing over 1.7 million people to come together and talk about issues that are affecting us on a regional basis and find out what other mayors are doing and how they're approaching things, and also try to do some long-term planning, how we can work regionally.
I would echo that, again, I think Williamson County sets the bar very, very high. The citizens require all of the mayors, all six of the mayors and the county mayor, to perform and to have good outcomes at the bottom line. There's differences in all of our cities. I had a question that someone asked me recently, what do you think about metropolitan form of a government? And I've always been opposed to that, mainly because I'm very pro-education, very pro-business, and I think public education always suffers under metropolitan form of government. The exception to that would be Moore County, but I think that's more Jack Daniels in a business model in that county. But your Davison, Shelby's, Knox, Hamilton, those larger cities, their education is always struggling under this big umbrella of dollars and cents that requires in the communities. I think the uniqueness of Ken and the other mayors outside of Williamson County, that's what makes our community so attractive. I can't imagine that Brentwood and Franklin and now Nolensville, the 10th fastest growing city in the state, or in the nation, excuse me. Spring Hill's in those high numbers like that too, that there could ever be a synergy of offering a metropolitan form of government that would be applicable or would be satisfactory. Now, from an economic standpoint, you know, that you could have some synergies of cost, but there are some trade-offs in everything you do. I think our Franklin Special School District, our Williamson County Public School Systems, our private school system, you just can't get a better education across almost anywhere in the nation than you can pick and choose and where you want to go to school and know that your children are going to get a good education.
That's great. So we're talking about partnerships. So I guess we should talk about partnerships with the state. Last week, you were part of Franklin Amaro's volunteer awards, and we've got one of our, I know at least one of our award winners is here, Cameron Cox, the Youth Initiative winner, but you were there and you spoke about the impact that our retiring 61st District State Rep. Charles Sargent has had on Williamson County. But we're looking forward. How do you look, what's the most important characteristic in working with the state legislators that we have? But say a little bit about Charles and that question to you too, Ken.
Well, first of all, I think it's important that all of us in this room, if you haven't early voted, then Thursday you need to vote from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. You have to go to your vote polling district. You cannot go to the early voting anymore. Once the polls are opened up, you have to go back to where you're registered to vote. So take time to vote.
Over 1,000 people voted at the new Columbia State Community College on Liberty Pike, a really easy location to vote. So that's great. And Brentwood Library, we had a turnout of about 13.9% during early voting, but Thursday is election day.
So it's very important that we realize the impact that Charles Sargent has had for the last 20 years at the state level. Most everybody in this room realizes that Charles and I are real good friends, and I will personally miss him up on the Hill. But he made the right decision. He wanted to retire and spend more time with his family, and I get that. The people that are running for the 61st District, which is a very hot contested race here in the county, and that's Little Franklin, Grassland area, all the way back over to Brentwood. So there is a huge turnout in those districts that are voting for that. And again, some of the candidates are here this morning. But it is critical that we work with our legislative group. From all indications, it's very possible we'll have a state representative be the Speaker of the House. It's a good possibility that Sam, in his second term, Sam Whitson, he'll move around a little bit and get his feet a little entrenched in some of the things that will help us out. And of course, Jack is just, from the Senate side, is true and tested. And so the replacement for that is so critical to Williamson County and the relationships those men will bring back down here. In the past, almost every issue, and I think Ken would say the same thing, that if it's something they're not real sure about, they get on the phone and they call us and say, what's your position? Whether it's the highway, the schools, city, county, and sometimes there are just differences between cities and counties, and we have to recognize that. But those men really have to do a balancing act, or women that are in those positions to be able to do the things that we've done over the last year. But it's going to be hard to replace Charles from the standpoint he's been the chairman of the Finance and Ways. That's the budget chairman. And so a lot of that attention from Columbia State, all the way to our roads and many other things, were the initiative and the footprint and the fingerprints of Charles Sargent.
You'll continue to see that, though, in the next few years as the parking garage starts and plans for the fourth building at Columbia State are already in the works. And Ken, you've played a large role in working with Charles and Dr. Janet Smith on Columbia State, but what do you think how working with the state is important?
Well, let me just start out by saying is that we have a great relationship with our state elected officials, and we welcome the opportunity before session starts every year to have a conversation about things that are concerns to us, and also they express to us what they think may be happening in the legislature. But you know, the legislature is a fast-paced operation with things changing at mock speed, I guess you would say. And they're quick to call us and tell us what's happening and alert us so that we can be part of that process and also give our input. And so I applaud the relationship that we have with Representative Cassidy and Representative Whitson, and we look forward to whoever ends up in the 61st seat continuing to have those same relationships. Charles Sargent, I don't have enough adjectives to in my vocabulary to say how much I think of Charles. You know, Charles has made such an impact on our county and our cities and our county with the work that he's done at the Tennessee General Assembly. And he truly is a great statesman, someone that's been able to navigate the complicated structure of the General Assembly and always looking out for the best interests of the citizens of Williamson County. But I think that certainly going forward for many, many years, people are gonna look back and look at all the great things that Charles did. But Charles has created a legacy in what he did for the community college, Columbia State Community College, that will live many generations down the road. The impact that he's made on the lives of children, future students at Columbia State, our business community with those relationships is just tremendous. And I did see Dr. Daryl Lampley here this morning, who's the charge of the new Columbia State campus since Dr. Shauna Jackson went on to be president of Nashville
State.
Yeah, but those impacts that Charles will have in the future will live many, many generations.
That's great. Thank you so much. And let's thank Charles. So I have 4 pages of questions that I could ask these guys. And we try to kind of assimilate them into topics and move forward in that way. But there are a lot of questions about growth and types of growth and how you balance that with the need for new schools and annexation. So we're going to talk a few minutes about growth and job creation. And wow, that's a kind of broad topic there. But this question is a kind of interesting one. What type of growth do you expect in Franklin and Williamson County in the next 5 years, and how will that impact this community? So, and then another question was, what can Williamson County do to foster innovation and new business creation? So where's the balance there for people who are here today? It's nothing new to hear. I wish I were the last person to have moved to Williamson County. But how do you balance the vision for the future, and what can we, type of growth do you think we can expect in Franklin and Williamson County in the next 5 years?
You want to get to the other questions, or you want to spend the whole morning on this
one? Yeah, we could stay here till noon discussing this, I think.
I think I hear a lot of concern among our citizens that we're growing too fast and that we're not keeping up with the growth and things of this nature. It is truly a balancing act to continue to offer all the infrastructure that our cities needs. But I feel very comfortable in that the city of Franklin is doing a lot of great things. You know, we're doing a lot of long-term planning. That's A good example is our integrated water resource plan, where we planned out our water, wastewater, stormwater needs for the next 20 to 25 years. We've got a 10-year master parks plan. We have a comprehensive transportation plan for the future. We have a land use plan that dictates how we do things and what goes where. We have a capital project list that we've projected out for 10 years. Unfortunately, on a capital project list, we can't do every single project on that. So we've already done phase one ranking those projects, and we've funded phase one. Now we're getting ready to go on to phase two and look to where we're going to be, what projects we'll do for the remaining 10-year window. The good thing about what we're doing is that as we rank those projects, we're connecting those projects to the funding source. And so it's not pie in the sky. If we pick projects, we know how we're going to fund them. As I mentioned earlier, we've been investing heavily in infrastructure. And for the next 5 years, we'll double what we've invested in the prior 5 years. I think that, you know, as long as we have the quality of life that we have here with great schools, an attractive place for people to live, a great place for people to shop, a great place that's good for families, we're going to continue to be a destination where people want to live, work, raise their family, and play and worship.
So I'll follow up on that. I think Ken defined the reasons is people are moving here. It's those quality of lives and issues that have been around for 20, 25 years. The schools, good jobs, low crime, et cetera, all of those qualities, Mindy. So the issue becomes now, it reminds me of back in the mid 80s, I want to be the last one to move here. How do we stop the growth? I hear that all the time. And you really can't stop it, but you can try to manage it. And the verdict would be out if we manage it. I think we do from a physical standpoint. The traffic, as Ken taught me a new word here recently, is called choke points. I believe that's the word he used, that different times and at different points of the day, we have horrendous traffic. Now, Columbia Avenue is bad for here, but my area of responsibility is going to be in the balancing and through the county commissioners and their funding and agreeing to these schools that we have got to build. So we the school board put together a program. They told us 10 years how much money they're going to need. We've attacked it twice in the last 2 years, once through the educational impact fee, that we're charging people that move here more money to move here. Unfortunately, that's tied up in the court system. The home builders didn't particularly like that. I feel comfortable about that, but it is a business model, so we'll see how that plays out. We also asked the citizens for a sales tax increase, and they voted 66% to do that, to help pay for these schools, the bricks and mortars. And then finally, our cities couldn't have done this without them. They forgave their portion of that sales tax increase for 3 years. So from the capital standpoint of building schools, we're addressing that. We put on the books in net value last year, new direct debt. We put on about $77 million. 92% of that was for, nearly 93% of that was for all school related issues. So our jails, our public safety, the sheriff's department, we're attacking that from the SRO, the student resource officers. We now have those in every single school in Franklin Special, Williamson County, and two in the high school. 5 years ago, as I reported last week, we didn't have a budget for that. That was, oh, by the way. Today, it's 32% of the sheriff's workforce, and it's about a $5 million price tag just in labors. And those are the things this county says, okay, fix it, make it work, take care of our children. There's no higher priority, we know that. But all of that costs money. But the whole while, our tax rate has remained very steady. It's the lowest in Middle Tennessee, one of the lowest across the state. And at the same time, our property values are just skyrocketing. And we passed Hamilton County somewhere in the last year for total values. We're at about $45 billion worth of values setting out from Brentwood to Bethesda and all points in between. So the traffic is an issue, no question. Ken's addressed it. I know the other cities have addressed it. We're addressing it out in the unincorporated area, but it's also working in partnerships. And when we get to choke points that we have to address, we all need to be at the table trying to figure that out along with the state. The future is very bright for Williamson County. It may not be as bright like we're seeing over the last 18 months to 2 years, because the economy can't sustain that kind of growth day in and day out. But we're poised. We've got money in the bank. We're all AAA rated. We ought to be able to handle the downturn or the flattening peak off time in 18 to 24 months. And I'm confident we can do that.
Well, let me just follow up just a little bit on that, because the issue you're talking about as far as this growth and demands on our infrastructure is not unique to Franklin. It's not unique to Williamson County. It's a regional issue. All the 10 counties in the metro region are experiencing significant growth at this time, and they're experiencing the challenges, maybe not as to the extent that we are, but they're also experiencing those same challenges.
So I think I didn't bring my phone up here. I thought there was, it's, so, well, we got some fun questions too. So, so where do you get your snappy socks? Somebody actually, I can show you that question is on here. Where do you get your snappy socks?
I think they must have looked at somebody else's socks. I'm pretty dull. I wear just regular old black or blue support hose.
Okay, well, that's good to know. Retired orthopedic surgeon, he knows what to do there.
You know, everybody, snappy to everybody is different, maybe. Probably talking about you, Rogers, snappy.
Rogers is looking for the question I'm going to ask him, aren't you?
Yeah. No, Ken, I've got golf socks on. They're 18 holes.
Rogers, your question, would you want your grandkids to go into politics?
No.
Okay. That's a good one. And then just really quickly, in a minute or less, they've each asked sort of what the day in the life is like, but there's also been a question of what would your dream day look like in Williamson County?
I think it's pretty good. I love being mayor. I love this county, and I mean, the days are long, and you do get gray hair for some of us. I wish I could tell you, you said a minute, but I wish I could share with you all the things that I know Ken does and the other mayors that make a difference in people's lives. That you're able to help people. And they're oftentimes just little insignificant things. But that's what a public servant is. I've been very fortunate. I was raised by good parents. There wasn't a lot of democracy at my house growing up. And whatever mom said, you did it. And that's the way life is. And that's not a bad way. I'm getting to be an old man now. And I love watching my grandkids grow. But there's just no better place to raise a family than Williamson County. And this county is phenomenal. Good education, you got a high chance your children are going to graduate from high school, 96%. You're going to have over the years that he's been here, and my entire career, it's been about, I'm very pro-business. You can't get enough jobs in this county for me. Because that's the end of the day. We got to feed our families, and we want our children to come back here and be able to enjoy and live and work here and play and worship. And it's just a great community. Low crime, nice quality of life. We've got some areas that we need to concentrate on, but the future is bright.
What's a dream day like?
Thanks for those comments, Rogers, and you're doing a great job. I think a grand day to me is a day when people continue to love where they live, love where they work, love where they're raising their family, and look forward to that opportunity for their children and their future. The hardest thing about my job, which I really love, is keeping Franklin that place. You know, Franklin has continued to be able to keep a unique charm about it as it's grown, and we'll continue to work very hard to make sure that Franklin is that place where it is a destination for people who want to live, work, and raise their family.
Great, thank you. So, Rogers, I thought you were going to say your dream day would be at the fair, August 3rd.
You need to put the plug in for that. Mm-hmm. Friday night, it kicks off at 5:30, 9 wonderful days of the fair. Whole bunch of new activities coming this year.
Go see the dinosaurs, right?
Go see the dinosaurs. Jurassic Park will be there the first 5 days. You've got grandchildren. I mean, there's probably some people in here do not know what Jurassic Park's is, but I can't imagine it. Yeah. And it's exciting even for gray-headed men to watch the smiles on the kids. It's educational. Still, the fair is non-alcoholic, and we're proud to do that. Thanks to the 1,500 volunteers, we'll pull it off again this year, I think.
Great. Thank you so much. Thanks to the mayors this morning. And while you're clapping your hands, I want to say thank you from myself and the Franklin Amaro Board of Directors to someone who plays an integral role in making this successful, and that is Carmen Stanek. Carmen's our operations director, administrator. She's been with us for about 2 years, and she is leaving this Friday to go on to a great opportunity with our friends at the Williams County Association of Realtors. So thank Carmen for her hard work. And she also coordinates the door prize that's going to get given away today, and that goes to Paul Crombie, who is an adjunct professor for humanities and history, and you can claim that at the Franklin Amaro table. This is our third in our quarterly Breakfast with the Mayors for the 2018 series. The next Breakfast with the Mayors is our final event, and that's set for October 30th, which will be the kickoff for the On the Table initiative that we discussed this morning. As we've also mentioned, important local, state, and federal offices are on the ballot this Thursday, August 2nd. If you didn't vote in early voting, please go to the polls Thursday from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. and vote for the candidates of your choice. All of this comes together with a great group of volunteers, and thanks again to Elizabeth Mefford and her committee for such a great program, and we hope you've enjoyed yourself. Thanks to Puckett's and MJ Roasting and Rolling Hills Pinnacle. Thank you so much, and we'll see you in October.